I'm Stephen Hand from Archery Supplies. Today I want to talk about setting up a new archery shop. So what I have here is a new archery shop we're just building as far as setting up. And I want to talk through some of the issues we have with setting it up and how you go about setting it up. But before I do that, I want to run through a quick history about me and about archery in this state, which is South Australia. So when I started, I was 12 years old. I'm almost 50 now. At the time, there was about four archery shops in this state. There was Archery Equipment, which was a small archery shop out north of Adelaide. Adelaide's got a population of about 1.5 million people. They probably had about 14 bows in stock, and they were the Yamaha dealers for Australia. So quite a small shop, probably the size of this shop, like a small room in a house, two bedroom size is what their shop was as far as size. There was another shop which specialized in bow hunting near the city that was called Broadhead Archery. That guy was the art director of Gallipoli, which was a film. He left it to go more into film and artistic. There was another archery shop called Arrow Archery, which was towards the city, but outside. There was also one called Sport Super Elliot's in the heart of the city. They were a bike store who specialised in archery. Arrow Archery was the Australian distributor for Darton Archery at the time, and there was also a guy in his backyard called Highland Archery, and he was the PSC distributor for Australia. Now, I'm going to say that these shops were very small at the time, and basically size has taken over. So I'm going to say Arrow Archery probably had maybe 15 to 20 bows in stock, and they were about two bedroom sized archery shop. Archery Equipment was in the base of his house, and he probably had maybe 10 bows in stock. Most bows would have to be ordered in, and there wasn't a lot to choose from back then. There was very few brands. So going on, my dad had not set up his archery shop when I was 15 years old. And since then I set up my own archery shop when I was 20. I then moved it to a shop at the age of about 26, moved to a big archery shop. We turned over about $5 million a year. That was probably three times the size of this. And then I moved back to my garage. Then I moved to Adelaide and set up another archery shop here. So this is another archery shop which we're now setting up. So we'll take you through it, and I'll take you through some of the issues. I went to America and I checked out about 50 archery shops in America to see how they run and how they display their stock to get ideas for my own archery shop. So I want to share some of that stuff with you. So to start with, I'm holding a bow. So one of the archery shops I supply said, can you do a video on how you display bows in an archery shop? Now this bow is a Golden Eagle Revolution. And at the time I was the Australian distributor for Golden Eagle. It was a very popular bow for me. And this bow just happens to be in the shop left here, so when the old owner left. So basically I'm going to use this as a display and a demo. So on the right here, I've got pegboard, slat wall. So one way to display these bows, and that's what I've done in my existing store, is purely to hang the bow on the pegboard, like so. Now, this is all good. It displays the bow really well, and the customer can see it really well. Now, the problem with displaying a bow like this on pegboard, it consumes a lot of space, and slat wool is quite expensive. The other problem is when you're fitting a bow quiver and stuff like that to the bow, it tends to make the bow stick away from the wall. Now, if you want to have lots of pre-built bows in your store, which is what I want to have with this store, which means basically the customers comes in, the bows are pre-set up with sights, arrows, quivers, arrows and kits, and they'll just walk away with the kit, let's say for $400, $500, $600, $700, $800 all set up. It's very hard to have bows sitting on the wall like so. Just because your wall's not big enough to house that many bows. Now, the other way I've seen people hang their bows is like that on the wall. So they have some sort of hook which hangs off of the slat wall. My problem was those hooks were quite expensive to buy, and if you got lots of bows to display in a shop, it turns out to be pretty pricey. So now the other way which I've displayed bows in a shop was I put down a bench, so a shelf, and the bottom wheel sits on the shelf, and the string attaches to a hook, like our little screw-on hook. So it's basically sitting like that. Now the problem I had with that was if this bottom wheel slides, then the whole thing collapses. And if you've got a whole bunch of these bows in a line, it tends to be like dominoes and they all fall over. So I had several options to overcome that. One was I put down little bits of wood, which these bottom wheels sat in. And it wasn't a bad way to display bows. Then I came up with a rack system, and this is what I used at Holder, in my Holder shop, which was one of my first shops. And you'll see the rack somewhere like something like this. Now I had this set up, and I had lots of hooks down here, and the bows would hang like that off a hook. And I had them hanging too high, like that and like that. So I'll try to zoom up. Now on this rack that I built here, this is basically a, and I only built one to show people what I was looking for. This is basically plywood with a frame of, this is 90 by 35 framing timber. And I'll just run around the side. These cost about to build, the ply board is, gonna get the numbers wrong, $50. There's two sheets of it, so that's $100. This plywood is, the pine framing is $3 a meter. There's probably, let's say 10 meters. So these probably cost me $130 each to build. Now in the shop fit out, I'm trying to reduce my cost. Okay, so I don't want to spend a lot in a shop fit out because I'd rather have lots of archery stock than an expensive shop fit out. Okay, I think archers, when they come to a shop, they want to see stock, they want to see variety, they want to see cool archery stuff. They don't want to. Archers tend not to be fashion conscious people, in my opinion. They more want to see the stock, they want to have product in the store, they want to see the latest products, they want to see things that are different. They are generally price sensitive. So that's my interpretation of archers. It's not like coming to a clothing store where people like to have a thing that looks very trendy. So my sister owns three clothing stores. Their shop fit outs, I think, are about 100,000 each. And they have nice stone walls. And you'll see here, we've got timber floors here. This is a slap, clipped together flooring. My sister's flooring is a lot more expensive than this. And they have nice sort of shop fittings. So for me, it's more, I'd rather have $100,000 worth of stock in my store than $100,000 shop fit out. So that's the other way to display bows. The other way to display bows is through the stabilizer. So they have a hook, which screws into the stabilizer, comes in there, and I've built these before. So I paid a fitting shop to make these little bars that come down, and then they stick into a rack. Now my problem with that was if the bolt's not tight here, then the bows slide to the side. Now I also found found them a little bit messy to get to. So we do have some of those displays, and in fact the PSE shop in Tucson just uses these little bow displays in round circles, and they have probably 10 of them in their showroom. That's what they do. How you display bows is up to you, it's personal preference. I'm going to hang the bows. I'm hoping to fit at least 12 bows on each side. We've got about 6 racks. So 12 bows each side, there's 24 bows, let's say 25 bows per rack. I've got 6 racks, so 120 bows in the store. That's what I'm hoping to do with the bows. So when it comes to the shop layout, one of the problems I had, so when I was setting up this shop, I said to the guy who's doing this shop, who's managing or whatever, I said, just build it. Build me an archery shop, build whatever you want, and go and set it up. And I suppose his thing was, well, it's your shop, you design it. And now my dad had a design for how he wanted this shop, which was different to the way he designed his own shop. So I'm going to show you how he designed this shop. So I'm going to move over here. So this is basically the front door of the store. Now the way my dad had this laid out was he had an L-shaped counter and then he had bow racks all down the center here. And along the side here, he had recurves and quivers down the wall. Now my dad's idea before he passed away was this shop would be a U-shaped shop with some racks in the middle. Bows would be on the count, on the wall, up high, and then there'd be stock on the walls in a U-shaped direction. Now, I don't really care how a shop's laid out. I'm more cared about that people come in here, that we've got stock on the shelves, that staff are happy to be working here. So I didn't really care how the shop was laid out. And in fact, when I laid out my current store in Lonsdale, my dad didn't talk to me for a year because I didn't lay it out the way he wanted it laid out. So my dad's plan was to have an upstairs story, which was going to be the retail store, and downstairs was going to be the stock. So it's going to be like a mezzanine floor, and upstairs all the would be retail, and downstairs would be basically all shelving, and that's where all the stock's displayed. But for me, that was too hard to build. It was too hard to design how to build a staircase, how people would get up the staircase if they were disabled. It was all too hard for me to build and to visualize how to build that. So my dad didn't talk to me for a year after that. So I'm going to show you the arrow rack. Arrow racks were a major component. So this is the arrow rack we've built this time. Now, there's several ways to build an arrow rack, and I've literally built arrow racks all different ways. One way was basically I get sheets of ply, drill holes through it, and basically use dowel through the things, and that forms the brace here. This basically is a lattice. There's one at the front, one at the back, and they've built it into the side here. So. Now, some of the problems with this rack as they've built it, and it'll be interesting to see how it goes, will be if the arrows fall down behind, the arrows have to actually be long enough to fit between the gap there, so we'll see how that kind of works out. The other thing is you can have shelves built in there, so it is what it is, but they've built a solid top on it so you can store stuff on top of that rack. Now, one of the things to consider when building a shop is about where you put stuff, as far as like release aids, made up arrows, target sights, hunting sights, stabilizers, where is this stuff going to be displayed? And one of the big considerations you've got to consider is about stuff that can be grabbed or taken. So people putting it in their pockets, so to speak. So it's a major consideration, especially high cost items, like things like release aids that are, you know, maybe $300 each. You don't want to generally have that stuff so customers can come and grab it, put it in their pocket. Scopes, like shrewd scopes, might be $300. Very small, expensive items generally want to be out the way of customers. So if you've got a counter, this is a counter here we're building. Well, I'm not building. People are working for me building it. And this thing looks awesome. I mean, he's done a fantastic job. This is hardwood. And it comes from... It just comes from a building supply shop here. And he's sanded it and polished it and sanded it and polished it. I think he's done three layers of
coat to it.
And oh my God, it feels great. I really want it in my kitchen at home. So I almost want to take that bench and put it in my kitchen and bring my kitchen bench in here. So on part of this, we're going to put a carpet. This is the carpet here. It's just a, this is a marine carpet that we got from the hardware store, and we're going to apply that. Now, part of the reason why you want a carpet on top of your bench is for when people come and put their bows in, you don't want their bows getting scratched. And if you're working on the person's bow, it's nice to have a soft surface for working on it. So you've really got two options. One's carpet and one's like rubber, a rubber foam. But, you know, for your normal stuff where you're working, it's nice to have a wood top. Now, display counters. So I haven't really decided yet how this is all gonna come together, and I think the shop will just come together over time. But we've got a big display cabinet here. Now, this was left over from the last store, and I think they'll probably move down the end of the store and probably put some target sights in that. So part of the question is what you're gonna store in display cabinets. So my things are, you want to display stuff in display cabinets that you generally don't want people to touch, but you want them to see. So key things for me would be target sights, knives, binoculars, electronic devices, such as rangefinders, maybe archery glasses. So high cost items that you don't want people to touch, that you want to be able to bring out of the cabinet to show people. So you've got to think about how big your display cabinet needs to be, how many of those items you're going to have. In fact, most of my display cabinets are so messy, and when I say messy, there's so much stuff in them, like I have serving material in them, string material in them. I have so much stuff packed into them. I have three or four display cabinets filled with target sights. So many target sights, you can't actually see them. Now that's because my shop is so big, I supply lots of stores. So I have so many sites. As a retail customer, you can't see them all. So it kind of makes it hard, if that makes any sense. So like the XL Achieve sites, I might have 10, actually I think I've got about 20 of them. So there's so many of them, you can't display them. Now a store like this, I'll probably want to have one or two of those. I want to have one or two of the various sites. In my store at the moment, I have six Shibuya recurve sites. Well, you probably need one in a retail store. And then when you sell it, you order in another one. So with this store, one of the big things which we're going to consider and we're going to come across is basically what we stock in it. So what type of stabilizers, what bows we stock, how we stock them, as far as, do you want to have the bows pre-made up, or do you just want to have individual bows, and when a person comes in, they choose to, you know, what kit they make up? Now, in a retail store, your busiest time is Saturday. Saturday from literally 10:30 to 12 o'clock, you are flat chat with customers for those 2 hours. So you want to turn over as much as you can in that time period, which means you need to have stuff pre-made. So when a person comes in, you can give them a bow, teach them to shoot it, and get them out of the store as quick as possible, because you've got so many people to serve. And that's what we want to try and accomplish in this store here and in my other store. So during the week, it's generally not, when I say not that busy, that's when you may have time for customers, and they might do a custom setup where they might spend half a day setting up a target setup. You generally don't have that time on a Saturday. So with this store, I'm just going to zoom around a bit so you can see a bit more of it. It's going to come to a stage where you're going to say, well, where do we fit? Where do we put the hunting recurves? Where do we put the quivers? Where do we put the stabilizers? Where do we put the release aids? Where do we put the hunting sights? Where do we put the broadheads? How many broadheads are we going to carry in this store? Because it's all very well to have 100 broadheads on the market, but literally this whole wall here would not house all the broadheads made in the world today. So you've actually got to choose which broadheads you're going to stock in your store, which is not easy. You try to find better selling items, more popular items, and basically just not stock the less popular items. Same with bows as well. It's no use stocking bows that are not going to sell in your store, even if you like them. So like last year I think I had the RX1s in my store, the Hoyt RX1s, which I was told was going to be a big seller. They didn't sell for me, so they're still sitting in my store today at a discount price, under what I paid for them, and they're still sitting there. That's not ideal. You want stuff that turns over. So in a store, you want high turnover items, but you need items that are going to encourage people to come into your store to look. Keep your store fresh as far as keeping new items moving in, and keep old items basically moving out at a discount. So it's a continual thing. If you've got an old item, you want to close it out at a good price to bring new items in, and make sure you don't buy too many of an item which then doesn't sell. So that's what we're up to. I hope I've addressed many of the questions. I'll try and do more shop videos, because I know there's a few people who watch on shops and setting them up. But my advice on setting up a shop, if you set one up, you start off small and work into it. Don't stock items that are slow, that you don't know are going to sell. Like, you never know if an item's going to sell or not. Honestly, like, I'm going to pick an item, dead center stabilizers I didn't know were going to sell or not, and they've been extremely popular for me. So I've hit huge goals with dead center. Victory Archery I picked up. I hit huge goals with those. There's going to be products you pick up are not successful, but they may be successful for another store for a different reason. So always, tread lightly, and so see how it goes. Talk to people, do your research, check price points, see how products compare. I find consumers are very clued up today when they come into a store about how much things are worth, how much they're paying, how much the other stores around the world and in Australia are selling that product for. So it's not like you can say, well, I'll buy a site for 100 and sell it for 200 when everyone else is selling that site for 150. That just doesn't work. So you might get away with it sometimes, but generally not. So I'm going to say that's about it. The other thing you want to consider is the price on labor when you work on people's gear in a shop, because we spend a lot of time with people and we don't charge. And it's very hard to cover wages for staff if you're not charging for the time you spend fitting peep sights, fitting ARRS, fitting sights, tuning bows, working on gear. Basically, archery does not have high margins. The margins are very, very low. That's wholesale and retail are very, very low margins. So basically, same as like a car dealership. Now, car dealerships have much higher margins, especially on the spare parts. But you've got to charge if you're going to do work. Like if you're going to glue points in, if you're going to cut arrows, you basically have to charge, because I mean, prices are so low these days, you really need to charge for the time spent with customers. So if you're gonna tie a peep sight in, fit D loops, cam time, fit strings to a bow, you either charge extra for the strings, or you say this is the price for strings and then for fitting. So you've really got to charge for that component. So anyway, this is the shop. This is where we're up to. Other things to consider when setting up a new shop: FPOS machines, point of sale systems, how you're going to manage your stock on the system, the website, which we're working on right now. One of my staff's working on it. So basically how you manage that, as far as, are you going to implement a system to manage your stock in and out? Is it going to be barcoded? How are you going to manage when a person comes in to buy a product? Are you going to put pricing on it? And it's not that simple to stick a price on an object, because when that object changes in price, So let's say you buy a sight for, which is $400. Let's say the Australian dollar moves and that sight moves to 450, and you originally it was 400. Do you then up the price to 450, or do you leave it 400? Some people say, well, you should leave that sight at 400. But when that sight moves the other way to 350, you can't leave that sight at 400. So you've really got to have a tactic which is, which keeps up with it. So I just tend to base my pricing on the Australian dollar, and then I monitor what everyone else is selling for in my region and around the world, and I try and keep up. Now, if I lose track of an item, because you have thousands of items and someone has undercut you, you literally stop selling that item. So you've got to be literally up on all the items all the time. So I spend a lot of time surfing the internet, checking what other people are selling for, checking what I sell for, because someone might undercut you, or they'll do free postage, you don't do free postage, and literally that item will stop selling. So anyway, now with all that being said, don't expect to make a fortune selling archery gear. It's certainly not like that, and you're going to say, well, why are you setting up a second store? Because I like archery. I really like archery. I think this store can cover the people's wages who work here. It's going to be a lot closer to most of the archers. It's on a main road, more road exposure. So I'll get more people shooting bows and arrows because of the location of this store. Where my store is more located to people who are already into the sport. So they've got to literally find me. Where this store will bring people into the sport. So this store, my concept is this store, people will drive past, have signs outside encouraging people to take up archery as a sport. Get them into archery, teach them to shoot, send them down to a club, because we've got heaps of clubs in Adelaide, send them to a club, get them enthusiastic, get more people shooting, and if they have a good time, they'll encourage more people in and the whole ball starts rolling. So just on that point, it's always been said to me, and I've always been, you know, like when shops close on it, they say, oh, it's because you're so big or whatever. To me, when I started in Canberra, the shop in Canberra sold $200,000 a year before I started. My first year selling for my garage, I sold $50,000. The next year I sold $200,000. The year after that I sold $500,000. The year after that I sold $700,000. The year after that I sold $800,000. I sat at about $800,000 for about 4 years, purely because I was part-time and I couldn't... It's very hard to sell more than $500,000 with one staff. So you run out of size. I didn't have the space to build up more stock. But in the end of the day, when I moved to a bigger store, I think I moved up close towards $5 million in sales. However, I had lots of staff. I think I was running about 5 or 6 staff at that stage in a big warehouse with lots of overheads. I was running TV ads. I ran TV ads during the Grand Prix in Australia. So it was a big time. Now, even though I'm selling lots of stuff, that does not mean I was making lots of money, because I wasn't. So I made most money when I was at home with low overheads and I was just running the business by myself. That's when I made the most money. Low overheads means basically if you sell something, it's profit. Here, when you've got a bigger store and you've got more overheads, more expensive, you've got to sell lots of stuff before you cover those expenses. So anyway, I hope that's kind of covered most things. If you've got any questions, drop them down. I can always do a video on it. And I'll do one when this store is kind of up and running and sort of when we've done more work on it and as we start putting stores in. And always keep in mind, people do not come to an archery store to see how the shop's laid out, to critique its woodwork or stuff like that. They come here to buy archery gear, to get advice, to set up a bow, to learn to shoot. That's why they come to an archery store, to see the latest stuff. That's why they come to an archery store, not for the flooring that we've got down, not for the coffee machines, not for the pretty toilet we've got out the back. So yeah, that's that's the whole thing. So, and also the whole layout of the store, as far as, you know, the way these racks will be displayed, it may all change. It may all change. The way this whole, the whole store's laid out, the way the counter's laid out, the way stock's located, it may all change. Because you'll go, I don't like that, let's change this around. It's quite hard to change stuff around. It's very time-consuming to change stuff around. But basically what I'm saying is don't stress out about how you set up stuff. You do your best, and then you go, okay, this is my best, let's see how it goes. So I hope that's been helpful. I'm Stephen Ham from Archery Supplies. Any questions, drop it below, and enjoy your archery. Thanks for watching. Bye. Yeah, just to finish off this video, I just wanted to tell you a bit about this artwork behind me. So part of archery is the people you meet in the sport, basically. It's part of the reason why you do it. Now, when I was 12, I used to shoot out my front yard, across my driveway and into the neighbor's fence. And one day I come home and this guy's done a head for me with a little apple on top of it, painted it, like William Tell. That guy was a painter who lived three doors up from me. His name was Saltbrush Bill, and he did this artwork for my dad in his store. So, and he'd painted a few walls and painted the front of this building. And that was 35 years ago. Anyway, thanks for watching. Bye.